Thank you. It's an honor to be here with you. A few years ago, our daughter was attending UVU. I believe it was the year that the college transitioned to be a university. She was the education senator while she was here. And so we have deep feelings for UVU and this campus and the things that are being accomplished here. I'm assuming this is a pretty broad audience with broad ideas about your degrees and what you want to do in life and what you want to do after you graduate and while you're studying. So I'm going to keep this at a pretty broad level, but I want to focus on evolution and what's happening in our society and in education and in your lives. This is very similar to things I used to be doing for 3 years and meeting in a large group. If you have any questions, if you want to call me out on my facts, you just say it anytime you want. Yes.
What was your name again?
Kai, K-A-I, Danish. Last name Hintze. Okay. I want to first start with just a comment from Winston Churchill, who talked about knowing the future and looking into the future, and said, "The further back you look, the further into the future you can see." And I've loved that statement because it's hard to predict what's going to happen in the future unless if you understand a little bit about history. Where are we? And where are you? And where are you in your progress? And how do we measure your progress? In the early 1700s, there was an admiral in the British Army. His name was Cloudesley Shovel. And he was the admiral over a country that had a great, great fleet. And they were a very proud nation for the fleet that they had. And he had served 3 years outside of England in a battle and was returning home. And the ships that he was leading, that he was leading at the time, it was in some very dense fogged waters. They weren't far off the shore. And they understood longitude and latitude, but they had a hard time measuring it. And they would measure by judging speed. They would put wood, they would drop wood off the bow of a ship, and as the ship passed it, measure the time with a sand glass and try to calculate how quickly they were going. So their ability to measure, they knew what to measure, their ability to measure was weak. And Shovel felt like they were at a point where they could drop sail and go, even though they were still in the cloudy area. And the man in the crow's nest saw rocks and shouted down, don't drop sail, there's rocks ahead. And Shovel was incensed. He was the admiral. He had been trained and had incredible experience. And they actually took time to shortly court-martial the person. He was hung and thrown overboard. And the ship's drop sail went forward, crashed into rocks. Over 1,200 people died. And in some obscure history, it says that he actually survived until he swam ashore. And as he got ashore, he had an emerald ring on. And he was killed and robbed for that ring at that time. But measuring where you're at, understanding where you're at, it's one of the most challenging things that we have in life. So what is evolution? A process of continuous change from a lower, simpler, or worse to a higher, more complex, better state. And so to introduce evolution, who's the one person we think of when we think about evolution? Charles Darwin. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about Charles Darwin. And what we've learned from him in his writings and in his experiences. Just quickly. British born, British educated. The ship he sailed on was the Beagle, and wrote some very interesting facts, some good facts. He was a naturalist. And he was a brilliant man and helped us understand a lot of things about evolution. I want to focus in on something very simple, but I think it pertains to you and today and your future. On his ship, the Beagle, what were the islands he went to where he saw so much and so many animals and so much Galapagos Islands? All right. And as they did that trip, left England, came down, went across South America, went through the Straits of Magellan, and came up the other side of South America on his way to the Galapagos Islands. And one of the birds that he was studying was finch. And if you've studied this, the bird actually has a different name, but for the lay person, finch is good enough. And one of the most fantastic things that he found out was this same bird had different types of beaks or bills, narrower, larger, and in different geographic areas where it lived, the survival, how easy it was to find vegetation and bugs and insects to eat, depending on the type of beak that it had. And when he was going up the shores of Chile and Peru and some of those areas, sandy terrain, the finches had a different type of beak. And when he got to the Galapagos Islands where it was rougher, there were more rocks, the birds had to dig deeper or poke harder into vegetation to get the fruit out. They had a smaller, thinner beak. The other ones couldn't survive there. The ones that had the smaller beaks were able to survive. That is something you can apply. And I want to kind of develop this. That's something we can apply and understand. Are we relevant? Are the skills that we have, the talents that we've learned, the habits that we've developed, are they relevant in today's society? Advantages of man over nature. And this comes from his writings. Protection of the weakest. We as people, we can protect people. We can train people. We can help them get to a better place, a better position. Improvement for the weak. And we don't have to wait for evolution. We can interrupt that and we can put ourselves in a better position. Individuals with the slightest advantages have a greater chance of surviving. And we see that all the time in society. We see it in business, we see it in our economy, we see it in the devices that you guys use. Who are these five people? Steve Jobs. Okay. What did Steve Jobs bring us? Apple. All right. How many people knew before you had an iPod, before you had an iPhone, how many of you knew you wanted that? He was a creator. He brought things to us we hadn't had yet. Now, how many of you have an iPhone or an Android phone? What do you do when you leave it at home? How many of you go back and get it? Oh, yeah, yeah. It is. It's hard to think about living without. Who else is up there? Bill Gates. Bill Gates has changed the world. And whether he bought DOS programming, I mean, but his company and what it has given the world is incredible. Who else is up there? Zuckerberg. Who has a Facebook account or uses some form of social media? Amazing. It's amazing. Who else do you see up there? Jack Dorsey. What did he create? What did his company create? Twitter. Who uses Twitter or reads Twitter? Okay, more hands. Who else is up there? Who? Jeff Bezos, yeah. And? Amazon. Again, these people, they understand advantages and they are creating changes in our lives and changes in the way we do business. And changes in the way we think. Let's go back to Darwin. Natural selection is daily, hourly scrutinizing throughout the world the slightest variations, rejecting those that are bad, preserving and adding up those that are good. Average age in here, 24, 25? Okay, all right. You guys are young. You guys are so young. Have you guys had anything in your youth that a gadget, maybe a type of phone, something that you've used in your youth growing up, in maybe middle school or high school, that doesn't exist anymore?
Tamagotchi.
Yes.
I am so old. What is a Tamagotchi?
Tamagotchi is like a little like egg-shaped like game thing, and the Tamagotchi was like a pet that you could feed. And
did it eat? Nice, nice. What else?
I had a Walkman when I was little.
A Walkman. Okay. Who still uses a Walkman? When I was little, I had headphones that looked like something that you use for snow, but it had an AM radio on it. And I was the coolest kid on the block because I had that. So, I mean, it's amazing to see what we thought was so important, but something has replaced it. That's better, that's faster, the quality's better, and it's cheaper. Technology, culture. How is society and culture changing right now? Are there any changes? Every day. You know, it wasn't very many years ago that people would write books about tolerating diversity. We don't say tolerate anymore. What do we say? Accepting. What's better than accepting? Embracing. What's as good as embracing? Celebrating. Taking advantages of different thoughts and different ideas, different cultures, different experiences, different education. And that is so new still in a lot of our society. And sometimes other societies are more advanced than we are in some of these thoughts. Thomas Friedman. Has anybody heard of Thomas Friedman? Today, after this, you go to the bookstore, you go online. No one goes to the bookstore. You go online and you Google Thomas Friedman. New York writer for New York Times. He is also syndicated in the Tribune and in the Deseret News. So I think three times a week you can read his articles. He is the expert on globalization. He is a great writer and has great resources and done a lot of study on globalization. He's written several books, The World is Flat, The Lexus and the Olive Tree. That used to be us, talking about how maybe in certain ways the United States is falling behind in some of the standards in the world. But I just want to read you what he said about globalization. Globalization is not a trend or a fad. It is an interweaving of markets, technology, information systems, and telecommunication systems in a way that is shrinking the world from a size medium to a size small and enabling each of us to reach around the world farther, faster, deeper, and cheaper than ever before, and enabling the world to reach into each of us, farther, faster, deeper, cheaper than ever before. That's what globalization is. Globalization touches each and every one of you. And it doesn't matter if after this experience at UVU, you go on to graduate school or you go on and get a job, you will be involved in globalization. And even if you don't leave Utah County, that business, that organization will be touched by the global market. And so each and every one of us need to understand how important it is to understand other cultures and other systems and to keep our knowledge as broad as possible. This was a sign in South Africa not long ago. It was on a billboard. And I don't know if you can read it, but it says German engineering, talking about the smart car, German engineering, Swiss innovation, American nothing. And there are cultures that feel that way, that for so many years during the Industrial Revolution, the United States led in so many products and so much education and systems, and now we're not always the one that's providing. And a lot of companies, a lot of cultures take pride in that fact. We don't want that to happen. We want to participate. We want to participate in that global environment. Okay, back to Charles. He said, if a country were to open its borders, new forms would appear, causing changes to former inhabitants. How are we changing? We are much more diverse than ever before. You know, at one time, the first settlers that came to this area before it was a state Who lived here and who owned it? Who lived here? Native Americans lived here. Who owned it?
Mexico.
What types of changes do we have now?
Borders, immigration.
Immigration, borders, lots of people that would like to immigrate, some for education, some to work. Different reasons, you know, will motivate people. Who in here speaks a second language? Who has used that second language living here? Yeah. Who speaks more than two languages? Good for you. There are cultures and societies where it is three and four languages that children are learning, not just maybe a second language or practicing. So that idea of speaking more languages, that opens up so many doors of opportunities to you for your future. Who has heard of Adam Smith? Who is Adam Smith? Economist, very nice. Name one of the books he wrote.
Wealth of Nations.
All right. We base our economy, we based our founding fathers of this country, based our economy on the book from Adam Smith, The Wealth of Nations. He talked about free enterprise. Do we still live in a free enterprise environment? A little bit. How free are we? Talking about Cloudsley Chevel and measuring where we're at, how do we measure if we're really free in the economy? Lots of ways you could try. Here's my best attempt. What do you think the average tax rate, if you accumulate federal, state, county, property, sometimes city taxes, sales taxes, all together, what do you think the average tax burden is on a citizen in the United States?
60%.
A little bit lower.
40%.
A little bit higher, about 48-49%. So on average, 48-49%, you're giving back to somebody else and they're choosing how to spend that money. How free are you? About 51%. And that doesn't apply across the board. Those are big swooping averages. But it's interesting to think about this idea of free enterprise. But Adam Smith, he said, it's not from the benevolence of the butcher, the brewer, or the baker that we expect our dinner, but from their regard to their own self-interest. Every year at graduation time, one of the news outlets will interview students that are graduating that don't have a job, and they're irritated, and they're mad, and they've got student loans that they got to pay off, and they're saying, "Where is my job?" And some think there's a promise out there. Where are the jobs? If you're studying, one of the axioms of higher education is critical thinking. One of the greatest gifts this university can give you or you can earn is the ability to think critically. And if you're studying a major that satisfies an inner desire to understand and to know that knowledge, but there's not a job out there, then you have to accept that. If you're in a major and you know there's a job out there and you can get an internship, then you're in a position to earn money. The butcher, the brewer, and the baker, they didn't go to work just because they knew society was hungry. They went to work because they knew they were making something society would buy. Where's the closest McDonald's? Okay, across the street. Somebody is over there making fries right now. I guarantee you, there are 200 people that are going to go there between now and 9 o'clock tonight and eat those fries. That person didn't go there to say, "I've got a social responsibility. I got to feed those 200 people." That person went to work thinking, "I got to make rent. I got to pay for my car payment. I've got a nasty habit of eating." it's all personal. It's very personal, and so you have to think that way. Now, if your degree, if that education is feeding an inner desire and you're happy to walk away and maybe there isn't a job out there, that's great. But society, in a free-based capitalistic economy that we live in, doesn't owe any of us a job unless if we're consistently changing. If we have that sharp beak on the finch and we can find the food, but if we have the big beak, we're gonna have to go somewhere else because we can't get to where the food is. It's not the strongest of the species that survive, nor the most intelligent, but the one most responsive to change. That is what you're learning. Who is a freshman right now? Okay, sophomores. Freshmen and sophomores. You are learning things right now that in 3 years, 4 years, when you graduate, won't be relevant. That is how fast, society changes and some technologies change and some of the principles we follow, depending on the field you're in. Who's studying accounting? Oh, come on. Thank you. Accounting, this is a solid back. I realize it's boring, but there's a job out there. Accounting hasn't changed in 500 years. Luca Pacioli helped develop the double entry debit credit system 500 years ago. That technology hasn't changed. That is a solid technology. More of you need to think about accounting. It's way boring. Okay, let me introduce one more person to you, Samuel Butler. Okay, Samuel Butler was a writer in the 1800s. Just quickly, he wrote a book called Erewhon, and it was a satire. He was making fun of British society at the time that he wrote it. And let's see, Erewhon, if you read Erewhon backwards, what does it say? Nowhere, yeah. So he was writing about a utopian society where everything was perfect and everything was great. And the whole thing was written as a satire. In a few of the chapters, he described machinery, and he was talking about the future, and he was describing machinery of the future. And in one of the chapters, he focused on artificial intelligence and artificial life. This is the late 1800s. Automobile manufacturing hadn't happened yet. Flight had not happened yet. And he saw into the future. He had a pretty good grip, well enough that he thought machinery at some time, technology at some time, could become artificial, could begin to think for itself. Do we have that today?
Yes,
without a doubt. Okay. In his book, he said, "It must always be remembered that man's body is what it is through having been molded into its present shape by the chances and changes of millions of years, but that his organization never advanced with anything like that rapidity which that of machines is advancing." So, I mean, he just saw evolution in man. I mean, men and women are getting taller, stronger, leaner sometimes, as you measure centuries of mankind. You can see evolution in how tall we are and in our weight. But he was measuring how quickly machinery was changing and how quickly technology was changing. And this is in the late 1800s. In 1975, I was in Grace, Idaho. Who has heard of Grace, Idaho? I got asked this question. All right. Who has been through Grace, Idaho? Nice. Grace, Idaho has maybe 700 or 800 people in it, but in every crowd, somebody has been to Grace, Idaho. I was in the basement of my best friend's house, and we were listening to records and reading a Rolling Stone magazine in the 70s. And there was an article that talked about record players in the future that didn't have a needle. And I could not wrap my head around that. I could not figure out how that record player could play Led Zeppelin, Deep Purple, Foghat, the greatest music from the 70s, without a needle touching it. Samuel Butler, in the late 1800s, conceptualized artificial intelligence. Kai Hintze, that is a 17-year-old in Grace, Idaho, couldn't get past what a CD player might be. I could not understand that. If you can develop critical thinking skills, if you can develop innovation and creation of what it is you're studying, you are going to add so much value to whoever you go to work for or the business that you create. Okay, quickly, Alexander Hamilton. Who is Alexander Hamilton?
First Secretary of the Treasury.
Nice. You guys are good. Which presidency, which president was he? Was he the third or fourth president of the United States? He was never president. Very good. Yeah. He ran. How did he die? Got shot in a duel. Yeah. Died the next day. All right. He was one of the signers of, he was one of the founding fathers and wrote much of the economic and socioeconomic base of the Declaration of Independence and other important documents, Constitution of the United States. He also influenced, he was the first treasurer, he also influenced presidents of the United States and wrote several arguments for defending manufacturing. And I'm going to show you some statistics of what the average person had been doing at that time. But the argument to defend manufacturing, create jobs with technology, independence of foreign nations and military supplies, obstruction of external trade, demand for the surplus that may be used at home, national independence and safety. So he believed in creating more opportunities for technology, creating more opportunities for different processes that were being done at the time. At the time in the United States in 1790, there was almost 4 million people in the United States. 90% of the labor force were farmers. 100 years later, 1890, almost 63 million members of the United States, 43% farmers. 1990, 246 million members of the United States, 2.6 are farmers. What happened?
Manufacturing.
What happened with farming? Okay, more efficient, automation, better ways to fertilize, better ways to get the resource from the ground. Today, what percentage of people farm in the United States? What's the population in the United States? 330 million. What percent are farmers? It's less than 2%. It's less than 10. Between 1 and 2. I mean, it is amazing what technology has happened, how it has helped the agricultural industry within the United States. What happens when we produce too much? What does our government do? What? You know what's interesting? Other countries don't want it. They have starving people. But they want to develop their own agriculture. They don't want to be dependent on basic staples, just like we didn't want to be dependent on basic staples. And so for years we gave it away, or we sold it through a subsidy. But then most countries said they didn't want it. And we went out and dumped it in the Gulf of Mexico. What do we pay farmers to do today? What? We pay them not to farm. We pay them to rest the land. And farmers get a nice check if they won't plant certain fields because we are too productive. And other countries want that. They want that technology. They want that technology. It's an interesting fact. I don't want to discourage anybody that wants to be a farmer because the government's paying you for not working. But Going back to Alexander Hamilton, arguments to expand manufacturing, create division of labor, so offer more jobs, extension of use of machinery or technology, additional employment to different classes, different people in society, promote immigration, furnish great scope to develop talents, to develop more talents, and expand enterprises. Do we want more immigration? What is the value of immigration?
Diversity.
What does diversity bring us?
New ideas.
New ideas. What else?
More opportunities.
It is a balance. There is a balance there. There is a balance there. But what Hamilton wanted more than 200 years ago, we still want. Because it grows. It helps us grow. It helps us create. It helps us innovate. Okay, so let's talk about the state of Utah for a minute. Brigham Young. First territorial governor for the state of Utah. In 1847, he had a buy local mentality. And they tried to create everything that they were using in this intermountain area, from Franklin, Idaho, down to Arizona and into New Mexico. And the idea was, let's produce it ourselves. Let's make it ourselves and let's produce it ourselves. Is that a good idea? I'll bet everyone today has consumed something that could not be produced in Utah. Did anybody consume something that there was no way it could have been produced in Utah?
Yeah.
What?
Mangoes.
Mangoes.
Yeah.
Nice. How much did you pay for those mangoes? Okay, what else?
NFL.
arena is as close as you're going to get. Or the Utes, or the Cougars, or Utah, the Aggies, or Weber. What else? There are certain things we can't do. And there's certain things we probably could do if we wanted to spend the technology, create the technology, but the cost would be out of sight. So what changed? When did globalization come to Utah? Very nice. Very nice. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. 1869. The railroad came. And from the west, they were bringing products from Asia. And from the east, they were bringing products from Europe and from Great Britain. And it changed. And it changed what was being manufactured in Utah. There are 4 buildings throughout the state of Utah that are ready to fall down that at one time were great enterprises, but we could not compete any longer with the rest of the world. Does anybody know what we used to make? White, very nice. Who said that?
Sugar beets.
And there are factories. Just there's one right here close.
Spanish Fork.
It's still standing, isn't it?
Yep.
Yeah. There are 4 of them that. We were great at creating, at making sugar. And then as globalization came around and the ability for transportation and communication to bring products here at a cheaper rate, we had to change. And so we have slowly changed and adapted to immigration, to globalization. Good thing or bad thing? Okay, it can't be both. But that's a good answer. Honestly, that's a great answer. You want to get something to eat tonight. Are you going to get the best, cheapest quality food that you can eat?
That would be ideal.
Okay, that would be ideal. Are you willing to spend a couple of bucks more for something that's more expensive? It isn't any better?
No.
Probably not. Who enjoys Walmart? Who despises Walmart? Okay, why do we despise Walmart? It's a sweatshop. Has anybody forced those Walmart employees to go there? That is the argument. That is the argument. They're not paying enough. They're not giving enough benefits. The consumers wear crazy clothes, and you don't want to walk in there to see the consumer. I mean, there's all sorts of arguments, but what does Walmart or a similar type store give us? They focus on the 20%, the 20% of whatever product that's the most that most consumers will consume. Focus on those and try to give them to you as cheap as anybody else. And it irritates us because we see smaller shops go out of business, we see family businesses go out of business, but what were they doing? They were charging us a little bit more for the same product. What is capitalism? It's consumerism, and what is survival of the fittest? I mean, those that understand change. And so you can go ahead and still dislike Walmart if you want. I'm not going to convince anybody. But they are doing what Adam Smith and what Hamilton created 200 plus years ago. They're trying to be the best at the lowest price. Okay, just real quickly. Utah, in the state of Utah, there's about 80,000 work sites, 85% of Utah's population and economic activity are within a 50-mile radius of Salt Lake City, so that Ogden down to this area, Utah County area. 75% of all companies in Utah employ less than 10 workers. Small business. Small business, they have to adapt. They have to change to remain relevant. They need a workforce that what? Understands how to adapt. Understands how to change. Understands how to think critically. Okay, we're not gonna look at these two next slides, but what they were showing was what is changing in Utah are jobs. There are jobs that are called on-the-job training. Well, you don't need a college education to get those jobs. Those jobs are shrinking in the state of Utah. Each year, there are more jobs that require an education and less jobs that are going to train you with on-the-job training. Okay, this is a little bit off, but average annual salaries in the state of Utah across the board. For people that have education, for those that don't have education. So this is a pretty broad number. It's not very meaningful. Okay, I want to show you something here real fast. These are some pictures of my grandfather. My mother's side of the family, they all lived to be 100. They don't look very good, but they lived to be 100. And my grandpa was super close to that. He was born in 1893. As an infant, 2 years old, his mother took him to the open house. There's a religious building, the Salt Lake City Temple, right in the center of Salt Lake City. They had an open house before the Mormons started using it as a temple. He was a two-month old, and she took him in there. She carried him in because she wanted to see the building. So in his 100 years of life, fought in World War I. His parents took a picture of him in a dress, but he was my grandpa. but lived 100 years in the Hunter area of Salt Lake City. In his lifetime, he saw the Wright brothers take flight. He saw Harley and Davidson create and manufacture motorcycles. He saw Ford manufacture cars and improve that manufacturing. He fought in World War I. He saw World War II. If you believe it or not, he saw Neil Armstrong walk on the moon. And I'm not going to go into that debate whether he was there or not. And he saw the Berlin Wall come down. And I remember as a youth looking at him thinking all of the incredible things that happened in his lifetime. And now, I don't think it's that amazing anymore. What has happened in the last 10 years that's more amazing? The evolution of computers, for sure. Computers have been with us a lot longer than 10 years, but what they can do now, for sure. What else?
Cars that drive themselves.
Google, cars that drive themselves. What else? The internet. What else?
New Star Wars movies.
That are believable. That's right, and people come back. I mean, you're pretty sure they were dead, and they come back. They're in the next series in some role. What else?
Just like with, TV and everything, like you can see the war is going on everywhere.
It's not just going around. Yeah, media and media coverage is incredible. When my wife and I were little kids, and we watched little clips of Vietnam and what was going on there, and now, whenever we've been in a war or a battle, there is a cameraman right there standing next to the soldier watching bombs take off. And I mean, it's amazing. That is amazing.
I think it was like last week where every person in Utah got like an Amber Alert. Like the communication skills are just amazing.
Yeah. We were in North Carolina at an event, but on my phone, I saw that Amber Alert. Yeah. Very good. What else? What else has happened in the past 10 years that eclipses the Wright brothers flying, that eclipses the Harley brothers and Davidson building motorcycles?
Eradicating
diseases.
He's trying to eradicate every disease.
Yeah. Is that amazing? I mean, that what you're living through, what you're seeing is so much more amazing than maybe those 100 years that my grandfather saw. Okay, I'm going to introduce you to one more person. He's actually from the state of Utah that I'll bet you've never heard of. His name is John Nesbitt. Anybody wrote a book called Megatrends and has written several books following that. When I was your age, I came back from a volunteer experience. I was enrolled at Utah State. I was working in Grace, Idaho, and this book came out. And he was talking about the future and how to plan for the future. And I just want to go through some of the things that he talked about 40 years ago. He said, we're becoming an information society and not an industrial one anymore, where technology is being pulled instead of pushed. So instead of forcing technology on people, we are continually creating technology to make life better, to make the workplace a better place. Global marketplace, from a short-term to a long-term strategy. And that is important. Who has gone to a business or in some type of commercial exchange and you felt like you were taken advantage of, you were ripped off? How many of you have gone back to that same business? What do we do when somebody applies short-term manipulation on us and maybe take advantage of us? Do we go back to those businesses? But that had been the practice of capitalism for several years. Take advantage of the customer. And now we're much more into a long-term perspective. From government support to more self-help. And I think that's happening. From representative to participative democracy, more people, more grassroots efforts getting involved, and we are seeing that today. Hierarchies to networking. Today in my job, I was in a 2-hour meeting with four other employees from different departments, from different divisions. Not one of us reported to the other person. But we were all working together to try to come to a solution. And that idea of networking, instead of just going up and down the chain of hierarchy, is changing in the business place. Your ability to communicate is incredibly important. I was sitting in a class, a big general ed classes, communication class. And the teacher said, this is the most important class you'll have on campus. And I remember looking at him thinking, there is no way that's an important class. My accounting class is way more important. I wish I could find him today. He was spot on. the ability to communicate, the ability to talk, to listen, to be persuasive, and to work with other people is one of the greatest skills you will learn while you're on this campus. One of the greatest skills you will be able to market as you go out and look for a job. Okay. My wife, when I was at Utah State, junior year for Christmas, she bought me an HP 12C. It was the greatest piece of technology you could buy if you were an accountant or a finance major. It was incredible. It was $400, $300.
It was a lot of
her paychecks. Yeah, it was great. That is a small app now on your Android, on your iPhone. I mean, that's how quickly technology is changing, and certain things become so irrelevant. HP made so much money, and they still sell the 12C. I'm not sure who's buying them, but they still sell it. Okay, I want to share a quick video with you that will take about 3 minutes. Whoops.
Thank you.
Okay, I just want to share a couple more thoughts. Is globalization going to reverse? No, it is not going to reverse. And we have two prominent candidates to be the President of the United States that at different times have argued against globalization or restructuring globalization or building walls. There has to be a balance, but immigration is a positive to every country. And to those like my wife and I who travel outside of this country to live in other cultures and other societies, hopefully we were taking something that was helping them. And those that are coming here are bringing technology and experiences and innovation that help us. And so there has to be a balance. You just can't shut the door. It doesn't help society. It doesn't help the country. We don't want America not to be involved. We want to be involved. And we want them to be involved in helping us become better also at that same time. Okay, just quickly, Star Trek, the old Star Trek, first generation. Who has heard of Star Trek? Okay, Captain Kirk, the guy that wore tight pajamas, and what was the name of the ship?
Enterprise,
nice. Who was this guy? Scotty. Okay, I think Star Trek was on TV for 3 years and then the series was canceled. This guy had the greatest acting job of all jobs. Every week he had one line and it was the same line every week. What did he say? Oh, you guys are way too young. What did he say?
Pick me up, Scotty.
No, that's somebody else. He was in charge of what? He was in charge of the engine room. Captain, I'm giving her all she's got. Oh, come on, you guys. Okay. So Star Trek, the Enterprise. Star Trek, the Enterprise. Who was the smartest guy on the ship?
Spock.
Okay. Okay, without a doubt, Spock. What was his role? What did he do on the ship? First officer, science officer. What did he do? He stared into space. Or at least that's what the camera wants us to believe. He was the smartest guy on the ship. But he was the strategy officer. He was looking forward. He was looking into the future and helping them make critical decisions. If you walk away with three things, your diploma from this campus, from this university, but you can think critically, because whatever you're studying is going to change. I promise you it's going to change. And you can communicate with people that are nice and with people that are ornery and hard to deal with. If you have that capability to communicate and to listen and to function with them, to create, there's nobody that won't hire you. That is what corporate America, that's what business wants. Communicators that can think. Let me just go to this slide right here. Albert Einstein, insanity, doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. Think about your personal practices. Think about your habits to get the best results possible. Vincent van Gogh, if you hear a voice within you saying you cannot paint, then by all means paint, and that voice will be silenced. If you feel like you can do something that maybe others aren't doing, do not follow that path. When I was at Utah State, a good friend was graduating about the same time I was. We had a language class together. And as graduation was coming closer, I asked him what he was going to graduate in. And it was a field of business that was not in the catalog. I said, you can't graduate. That's not in the catalog. The school's not going to give you a diploma. And he had figured out what he wanted to do in his future. And it didn't fit Utah State's catalog. He went and talked to a counselor and said, this is what I want. This is what I want for my future. And they adjusted it. They became flexible for him. You think what you want. Don't follow a catalog. Decide what you want to do and go get it. This woman was on a billboard not long ago. At 85 years of age, Betty West walked across the Marriott stage, Brigham Young's oldest graduate. She had started 70 years earlier. In the United States, though, Nola Oaks, at age 95, received her bachelor's degree. At 98, she received her master's. There is no age limit to learning. There's no age limit to continual learning. One last video. This one takes 60 seconds, and then one last slide, and we'll finish.
Here's to the crazy ones, the misfits, the rebels, the troublemakers, the round pegs in the square holes, the ones who see things differently. They're not fond of rules, and they have no respect for the status quo. You can quote them, disagree with them, glorify or vilify them. About the only thing you can't do is ignore them. Because they change things. They push the human race forward. While some may see them as the crazy ones, we see genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do.
You are not here for a diploma. You are here to create fire in your belly. This isn't getting a diploma, filling a bucket. It's developing a desire to learn that's going to help you continue to learn the rest of your careers, the rest of your lives, because you are being thrown into a job market that's going to rotate and change continually. And you have to be a thinker. You have to be able to think critically. Thank you for letting us be here. Thank you for letting me share my ideas. Good luck to every one of you.